Well, good morning, everybody. Wow, I'm right here, aren't I? Well, stand with us. We're going to worship an everlasting God today, so stand with us.
Unchanged by all the vanities of man. And as the nations rise and fall, their sovereignty remains. You are, you are, you are the one true God. From everlasting, from everlasting. In faithfulness, your love extends through times of turbulence, adopting those who call upon your name. And every generation joins its songs of grateful praise. You are, you are. Faithfulness, your love extends through times of turbulence, adopting those who call upon your name. And every generation joins in songs of grateful praise.
You are,
you are, you are, you are the one true.
Immortal, invisible, God eternal.
Each other in the name of the Father. Good morning, Karen community.
Good morning.
All right. Nice fall day, right? Getting a little chilly. Praise the Lord, it wasn't snow. I'm so not ready for that. All right, let's take a look in our bulletins. From everlasting to everlasting. I love that line, that He is sovereign in the midst of our turbulence. So whatever turbulence you're facing this morning, we all got it, right? Everybody's got challenges. He's sovereign over that turbulence in your life. What amazing truth. What amazing promise. Hey, take a look at the inside of your bulletin. First inside cover, just a couple things happening this week. I will trust you to read your bulletin. There's some updates in there for things coming in the future. So we're not going to review all that. You can read that and respond. But tonight at 6:30, there's a mini youth group that's meeting here. So you want to be part of that. If you have any questions, see Kendall. Kendall, wave. There she is. See Kendall. All right. And I think Mel in the back. Mel, wave. She's in the back. So you got tag team in the corner. They oversee that. And we're also having a trauma healing also at 6:30. And that particular course is something you can drop in on any week. You don't have to have been part of it to drop in. Beth is waving.
But please note the announcement. There's only two more classes.
Right.
Thanksgiving.
There is an announcement in there about an adjustment in the schedule for trauma healing. So if you are interested in that course, read that announcement and note that for your own scheduling. Then normal stuff that's going on this week. Tuesday's the Plarn, Wednesday House of Prayer and Worship Prep. Thursday, the Safe Harbor Group. Sue, wave. There, Sue, if you are. All right, Safe Harbor, for those of us that are older than we want to admit. Okay, that's the group. That's the group for us. And then Saturday, Trunk or Treat is happening here starting at 6 o'clock. And there is also an announcement in your bulletin that still needs some trunks, some things that will be decorated for the kids to come around and get some treats and have a good time. And there's a handout. So you can use this, utilize it, give it to a neighbor, give it to a friend, family member. So utilize that as a handout to make that known in the body. So they still need some trunks, so keep that in mind as you are interfacing with your sphere of influence. And then there's an announcement near the back, our loving in the name of Christ, the auction. Today's the last day to get anything in on the auction. There's a website that you can visit so that you can respond to that. Just a reminder, coming up on the 7th of November is our 30th anniversary. We're going to celebrate that. On that day, we will not have discipleship hour. So teachers, you're going to get a break from that. There'll be some setup that's taking place for the luncheon. So on November the 7th, we will not have discipleship hour that particular Sunday. So please take note of that. Yes?
There's a whole lot of other things also happening on the 7th.
There is. Yeah, there's a lot of stuff happening that weekend. Yeah, so just be ready for the weekend of the 6th and 7th. Yeah, maybe most importantly is the night before you turn your clocks back, right? Spring ahead, fall back. So if you don't do that, might be, what, you'll be what, late or early? You'll miss it, yeah, so whatever. So just turn your clock back, you'll be okay. All right, so all that's in your bulletin. Sheldon is preaching this morning, and this Wednesday, he'll be doing the funeral for his brother Gary. So this is the second funeral in just a couple of weeks, back-to-back funerals. So as they as a family are grieving with hope, and they are grieving, he still is ministering to his family and the larger community that's down in the Bethlehem area towards Allentown. So we want to pray for them, but there is, you know, a lot of loss and a lot of challenge, sickness, disease. Everybody's got challenges. And this song, this opening song, I mean, Denny had no idea that God laid this on my heart last night. So I want us to turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 8. It will be up on the screen for you. Just a couple verses to give us a perspective from which to respond to the challenges we face. Because when we face some of these challenges, we're tempted by the enemy to veer into hopelessness. To think, you know, everything's falling apart, my body's falling apart, people are dying around me, and, you know, is it worth it? The enemy would love to lie to us and say, you know, is it worth it to continue in faith? And the answer, of course, is yes. But this passage from Paul to the Romans in chapter 8 gives us a little bit of eternal promise and perspective. And it's from that perspective we are able to respond to loss and grief and challenge and sickness and disease. Romans chapter 8, start with verse 18. Paul's writing to us, to the church. I consider that our present sufferings, anybody have present sufferings, or does everybody have present sufferings, right? Different storyline, but we all share in the fact that we have challenges. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. That's the promise. The creation waits in eager expectation for the sons of God to be revealed, the children of God, those who are part of his family. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay. Do you want to know what's going on in the world? We are in bondage to decay. We are not getting better. We are decaying. That's the reality of a fallen world, and yet there's hope and promise in the midst of it. Bondage to decay and brought into the glorious freedom of the children of God. Promise. We know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption into sonship, the redemption of our bodies. That ache, that pain, that falling apart in your body, it will not be forever. It's only this side of eternity. It's real to you now. The suffering is real, but it is not forever. It is not eternal. For in this hope we are saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what he already has? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. If you're struggling with patience, understand that God is with you in it. Why? In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for. You find yourself doing that? At times in the morning, I pray and I'm like, God, I don't even know how to put words to this, Lord. But the Spirit knows. The Spirit prays with us and for us. The Spirit himself intercedes for us with groans that words cannot express. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints in accordance with God's will. He is praying his will for you. That's what God is doing. Praying his plans and purposes for you. And we know this morning, brothers and sisters, that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. So I want to encourage you in that, and I want to just encourage you to maybe expand the move of the Spirit this morning. We are called as a body to care for one another and to pray for one another. Paul talks about a time when he was in such despair and he was actually carried along by the prayers of his fellow believers. And so, you know, as we worship this morning, I encourage you to respond to the prompting of the Spirit. If you need prayer, you say, I need to go to this person, I have a relationship with them, and I need some prayer this morning, respond to that. We're not worried about this has to be a service the particular way. Let's loosen that up. I'm not talking about chaos. I'm talking about responding to God's prompting, responding to the Spirit. If you're led by the Spirit, I'm in a relationship, I know that person needs prayer, I'm going to go and pray for them. Do it. Respond to God's Spirit so we can continue to encourage one another in these promises and walk with one another, spur one another on to eternal perspective. Beth has something she wants to share that God showed her about what happens when we are worshiping, and I'm going to pray over us, and we're going to continue to do that.
It's actually something Denny asked me to share. I shared in our prayer time before we came out for worship yesterday. Our friend Darlene sent me a worship song called Echo Holy by Red Rocks Worship. She sent it in the morning. I'm just going to read the beginning lyrics and then a comment that she made from that. Gathered at the highest throne, welcomed by a melody, an anthem I have always known, a song that's always been in me, all glory and honor, dominion and power to you. A million angels fall face down on the floor, all to echo, holy is the Lord. My heart can't help but sing with all of heaven roar, forever echo, holy is the Lord. Down for a sec, because I want to read her comment in this. I sent back, you know, that was just like we had chills listening to that song. And then she sent back this comment. I love the thought of when we are worshiping with all in heaven, bring heaven to earth. And I thought about how I don't actually recognize the reality of that when I'm worshiping. That as I'm worshiping, the angels in heaven are continually singing holy, holy, holy around the throne. So think about that as we worship this morning, that we are joining with all in heaven, all the angels in heaven singing, holy, holy, holy is the Lord, that our worship is rising up and meeting their worship, and we are creating a cloud of glory around us. So bless you in that.
So invite you, you can come to the cross, get a flag, just respond to the move of God's Spirit. Let's pray together, and then when the worship team will come, we'll continue in our worship. Lord, we are so grateful for your word
that the Word became flesh, Jesus, that you came to show us the way. As we were singing, God is immortal, He is invisible, but you made yourself visible so we could see. And now we make you visible to the world around us by how we know you and make you known and continue to demonstrate your character in and through our lives. So help us in the challenges that we face. For Debbie and for Sheldon as he goes and ministers, God, an anointing and an empowering that comes from he is grieving, they are grieving, and yet there is this eternal hope and promise that sustains them and needs to be communicated, because there will be those there that come to Gary's service that do not yet know you. And they need to have that eternal perspective to change how they deal with the loss and the challenge in their lives, so they are not hopeless, so they are not in despair. I pray for us in this room who are tempted to go in that direction, that you would remind us through your presence, through worship, through fellowship, through praying for one another, through the truth of your word, that you are with us, you are sovereign over it, you are working your good in our lives, you have purposes and plans. Nothing touches us that doesn't go through you first. Embed that in our hearts and minds and give us courage, give us strength, fill us with your promise, and let that flow through us as we interact with the world around us. Lord, we know they are watching how we face our challenges. Let us face them with hope. Let us face them with faith. Let us make you known in the midst of the turbulence in our lives. God, we give you all the glory. We give you all the honor. You are worthy of our praise. We're overwhelmed by your love for us and the promises you have made to us. Help us to respond to you in a way that brings you honor and glory and makes you known. In Jesus' name, amen. Worship team.
How many of you were baptized in a river? Hold up your hand. Two. I knew there was one going to be back there in the corner. Karen was baptized in the Susquehanna River. Back when the couriers, is that a name that's familiar?
Wow. Yeah.
The couriers came to David's church up in Millersburg. And they had a baptism service in the river. And Karen went. My own experience wasn't in a river, but it was. I was called to the river. Okay. And we're all called today to clean up our temple. To allow Jesus to clean up our temple. So let's go to the river.
To the river I am going, bringing sins I cannot bear. Come and cleanse me, come forgive me, Lord, I need to meet you there.
To the river.
To the river I am going, bringing sins I cannot bear. Come and cleanse me, come forgive me, Lord, I need to meet you there.
Precious Jesus,
precious Jesus, I am ready to surrender. these waters, healing mercy flows with freedom from despair. I am going to that river, Lord, I need to meet you there.
In these waters,
in these waters, healing mercy flows with freedom from despair. I am going to that river, Lord, I need to meet you there.
Precious Jesus,
precious Jesus, I am ready to surrender every care. Take my hand now, lead me closer, Lord, I need to meet you there.
Come and join us.
Come and join us in the river. Come, have a life beyond compare. He is calling, he is waiting. Jesus longs to meet you there.
He is calling,
he is calling, he is waiting. Jesus longs to meet you there.
Precious Jesus,
precious Jesus, I am ready to surrender every prayer. Take my hand now, lead me closer, Lord, I need to meet you there.
Take my hand.
Take my hand now, lead me closer, Lord, I need to meet you there.
Lord,
I need to meet you there.
Purify.
is to be
refiner's refiner's fire. My heart's one desire is to be holy, set apart for you, Lord. I choose to be.
Be unto your name, holy, holy. folk in this place.
Be unto your name.
Speak to us.
Be unto your name, Lord. Be unto your name. Be unto your name. Holy, holy Lord God Almighty, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Highest praises, honor, and glory be unto your name.
I was standing with the angels. So thank you, Lord. Thank you that you draw us to places on earth like in heaven. Thank you that we can join with that and lift up more powerful praise to you, because you are worthy. You are worthy. Come on up.
What a beautiful sound that was, to gather together and praise the name of Jesus. Let's pray. Lord, it was great sound because you deserve it. You deserve our praises. And I pray, Lord, that these little ones up front was hearing that praise. Lord, I pray that they hear it at home in the morning when they arise. They hear it at home at nighttime when they go to sleep. Lord, I pray that they hear it in school by the power of your Spirit within them. I pray that they hear it now as they join with the teachers, as they speak about your truth and your love for each one of them. The Lord, may they grow up to sing your praises. Lord, we thank you. We are grateful. You deserve our honor and our glory. May you be forever and ever worshiped. And Lord, may you raise up these little ones to be worshipers of the Lord Jesus Christ. We ask this in your precious name. And the church said, amen. Got a few more girls this morning than it's normally a bunch of boys running back here. Continuing in the book of John, also known as the Gospel according to John, since we started this, Pat has asked this question several times: what is your passion? Ask in other ways, what do you want? What moves you? Truth be known, for some of us, the answer is nothing. Nothing moves us. And many times we demonstrate it very well. But I'm not talking about 1 Corinthians 15, where Paul is talking about the resurrection. And at the end he says, the sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Another translation for that is, let nothing shake you. That's a good thing. demonstrates a strong and steadfast faith no matter what the circumstances that we face. But I'm talking about something else. What gets your blood flowing? What stirs you? What arouses your passion? What gets you excited? Again, for some of us, that's nothing. We get our coffee, we pick our seat. Coffee lasts to the end of the sermon. We're thankful for that. And we leave until next Sunday. We just got our routine going for us. As long as that routine stays the same, we're good. But maybe that's it. Maybe when your routine gets upset, then look out. You're ready to be stirred. But the truth is, for all of us, something inside us, something will get us going. You know, this time of year, it's football games. We get stirred up. Any time of year, it's politics. As soon as we start talking politics, some of our blood boils. Many things can stir us, but are they important? Are they good? In today's passage, we'll see what moves Jesus. What gets his blood boiling? He's facing something unworthy, unjust. And we see some righteous indignation. Turn to John chapter 2, starting with verse 12. John chapter 2, verse 12. After this, he went down to Capernaum with his mother and brothers and his disciples. There they stayed for a few days. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Let's just stop here for a second and talk about geography. After this, obviously referring, John is moving from one narrative to another. Last week, we saw the first miracle change water into wine. That was done at Canaan. Pat did a great job of leading us through that last week. Now, Canaan is in the mountains, and Capernaum is next to the Sea of Galilee. So obviously the elevation, Jesus went down to it. Then he goes up to Jerusalem. There's a lot of ups and downs in Jesus' ministry. I mean, he came down from heaven, then he went back up to heaven, and he's going to come back down. A lot of ups and downs. Matthew 4:13 tells us that after John the Baptist was in prison, Jesus left Nazareth and went to live in Capernaum. Luke 4 tells us why, the reason why. Because everyone in the Nazareth synagogue was furious with him. The very synagogue that he grew up in. They were furious with what he said. They didn't like it. In fact, to the point that they attempted to take him over to a cliff and throw him off of it. But they couldn't touch him, couldn't lay a hand on him. He walked right through them and all the way to Capernaum. But soon as he got there, he went right to the synagogue in Capernaum. And eventually, that became his base of operations, and it made perfect sense because it was a good location. Plus, three of his closest disciples lived there: Peter, James, and John, the writer of this book. And we see that when he went there, he wasn't alone. He went with his mother and brothers and disciples as well. The brothers, actually, it's his half-brothers, contrary to the Catholic belief. These were actually future sons of Mary and Joseph. Mark 6:3 tells us their names were James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon. And also Mark tells us that Jesus had sisters as well. But the time to part company with his family was coming soon. Not now, but it was coming. Spending more time with his disciples and less time with family would soon be upon him. That's simply part of doing business in God's kingdom. Simply part of doing business. Part of the cost that we as believers need to count. Because there's many a servant of God, whether they're missionaries, pastors, anybody, any servant called away from family to another place, must count the cost. Sometimes it's just temporary, like a missionary trip. You leave your family to respond to what God's calling. Other times, it could be permanent. You choose to follow Christ, and some of your family members do not. Some of your family members do not. It could be heartbreaking, but it's very, very possible that you will face a permanent separation. Turn to Mark chapter 3, verse 31, 34. We'll look at what Jesus has to say about this subject. Mark 3, verse 31. It says, then Jesus' mother and brothers arrived, standing outside. They sent someone in to call him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they told him, your mother and brothers are outside looking for you. Who are my mother and brothers? He asked. Then he looked at those seated in a circle around him and said, here is my mother and my brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother. Membership in God's spiritual family, evidenced by obedience to God, is more important than membership in your human family. That's a hard thing to say. It's a hard thing to hear. But is it not true? Is it not true? Saying yes to Jesus may mean saying no to family. But then Jesus also follows up in Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10, verse 29. He says, I tell you the truth, Jesus replied. No one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me and the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age, homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields, and with them persecution, and in the age to come, eternal life. See, life as a disciple of Jesus Christ, it's a combination of promise and persecution. Blessing and suffering. And God takes nothing from us, nothing from a believer, nothing from a Christian, without making multiple restoration in a new and glorious form. Obedience to the Father's will, Jesus knew what it would cost him. And he has made it clear to us that we should prepare as well to understand that cost. So he spends a couple of days in Capernaum and then up to Jerusalem again. Jerusalem is about 2,500 feet in elevation, so obviously he got to march back up the mountain. And it's important. The Passover was the most important Jewish feast of all. Commemorates God's deliverance from the Israelites out of Egypt. You can read that in Exodus 12. And it's one of three annual pilgrim feasts that all Jewish men were tasked to celebrate. Deuteronomy 16:16 says, three times a year, all your men must appear before the Lord your God at the place he will choose. At the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Feast of Weeks, and the Feast of Tabernacles. The Feast of Unleavened Bread, that's the one that's celebrated with the Passover, usually at the latter part of March or the early part of April. Feast of Weeks was either May or June, and the last one, the Feast of Tabernacles, was sometimes in late September, early October. But Jesus going up there was simply to obey God, to obey his Father. And John calls it the Jewish Passover, and rightfully so. It is particular to the Jews. Now, his Jewish readers would understand that, but at the time John wrote this book, it was around 85 or 90 A.D., long after the ministry that he is describing, long after this time. And many of his readers by then, John knew, would be Gentiles. So he's not mocking an old order of things. He's simply being descriptive in talking about this Jewish Passover. And of course, he was a Jew as well. But nonetheless, we all should celebrate Passover, not particularly the Jewish one, but being a believer in Jesus Christ, being set free by his blood, we have our own Passover. It is Jesus. The blood that he shed spread over our sins. And on the judgment day, God will remember them no more. He will just pass right over our sins. And I don't know about you, but all I can say is hallelujah, praise God, thank you, Jesus. Verse 14. In the temple courts, he found men selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and drove all from the temple area, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, "Get these out of here. How dare you turn my Father's house into a market?" Now, this is his first trip to Jerusalem in his public ministry. In his public ministry. And where does he go? Straight to the temple. And the first thing he does, he purges it. He purges it. Turn to Malachi chapter 3. Malachi would be the last book in the Old Testament. Of course, it'll be up on the screen behind me. Malachi chapter 3. Starting with verse 1. "See, I will send my messenger who will prepare the way before me." That's John the Baptist. "Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant whom you desire will come," says the Lord Almighty. "But who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when he appears? For he will be like a refiner's fire or a launderer's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. He will purify the Levites, the priests who administered in the temple, and refine them like gold and silver. Then the Lord will have men who will bring offerings in righteousness, and the offerings of Judah and Jerusalem will be acceptable to the Lord, as in the days gone by, as in former years." Excuse me a second. So what is Jesus doing? He's doing exactly what God said he would do. He would come to purge. He is purging. He is purifying. He is refining. And at this particular time in the temple, there's two groups of people that are targets of his righteous anger. The sellers of the animals, the cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers. Those selling the cattle and sheep are driven out by Jesus along with the animals. Those selling the doves are told to leave. Why? Because the doves are in cages They can't be driven out. They need to be picked up and carried. So he tells them to leave. They do. They're carried out. But these two groups are absolutely necessary for the Passover to take place. They offer very important and valuable services. The animal sellers, they make it possible for the long-distance travelers that come to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover, they make it possible to buy animals necessary for the sacrifice. Instead of having to lead them or carry them all the way from where they're coming from to Jerusalem. It's a great convenience to have them there. Same with the money changers. The temple tax must be paid by every Jewish male 20 years and older, but it must be paid in the local currency. So they're coming from all kinds of different places, bringing their change, so they have money changers there to change it to the local currency so they could pay the temple tax. So the problem was not in doing that business themselves, not the selling of the animals for sacrifice, not the exchanging the money for the tax. And Jesus wasn't even dealing with the high amounts they would charge. He's not dealing with that at this point. That's not the problem. So what is the problem? It was superseding of the business culture and the worldly gain over the authentic worship of God. And it's not an unknown subject. Jesus talks about it a lot of times. Matthew 16, 26, Jesus says, "What good will it be for a man if he gains the whole world, yet forfeits his soul?" He knows we battle with that. On an individual basis, we all tend to struggle with that. And he offers us help. Turn to Matthew chapter 11. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28. It's a very common passage. Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Jesus does not force us into worship. He does not force us. He leaves that choice to us. But this, what was happening here in the temple, something different. This was the priest and the other so-called spiritual leaders leading the people in profaning the house of God, the place built for the presence of God to dwell. And for Jesus, that is his Father's house, and he would not have it. His righteous indignation was upon him. He's seeing in living color the words of Ezekiel 33:31, "With their mouth they express devotion, but their hearts are greedy for unjust gain." So greedy that it consumed this place of worship. The marketing was disrupting at best, but preventing at worst, especially for the Gentiles. See, the temple was constructed with a large walled-in court area on the outside. And the Gentiles were not permitted inside the temple, so when they come to worship, they did the worship outside in the courtyard. But all this marketing going on, places filled with animals and doves and money changers, it not only, at best, it disrupted their worship, and at worst, it prevented it. You know, Jesus saw this as not only insensitive, but downright religious arrogance on the part of the Jews. But there's one more thing that's a factor here in this episode, and that's God's timing. No doubt Jesus, he's 30 years old, no doubt he had been to the Jerusalem temple before. He's required to have been there. He probably saw this happening before. But now this is the start of his public ministry. It's time for his unveiling to begin. God's timing. So he identifies this temple as his Father's house, and therefore identifying himself as the Messiah. And the results, he purged the temple without any assistance. I mean, he wasn't into gathering up a mob. He didn't need one. And he purged the temple without any resistance, not from the market people, not from the priests who issued their license. Probably a combination of their guilty consciences, they knew they were wrong, and the power of his presence. As I read from Malachi, it says, "Who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when he appears?" He purged the temple. Verse 17, chapter 2. The disciples remembered that it is written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." That quote comes from Psalm 69:9. One of Jesus' disciples was called Simon the Zealot, for his religious zeal. Romans 12:11, Paul encourages every believer to never be lacking in zeal. Jesus' zeal was not some blind national pride, but it was real and it was righteous, because he was all about bringing honor and glory to God and the true worship of God. And so great was his zeal that it says it would consume him. It would consume him. It consumed him the way he lived. His sole purpose and goal was to obey the will of the Father. It consumed him. So great was his zeal that it took him all the way to the cross. And being consumed, the prophecy was fulfilled in his death. A death which brought life into the world. As Pat mentioned, I'll be burying my brother on Wednesday. And we buried his grandson last week. And we do so with great hope. All because made possible by the zeal of Jesus Christ. Oh, might we have the same zeal for him. Let's read on. Verse 18. Then the Jews demanded of him, "What miraculous sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple and I will raise it again in 3 days." The Jews replied, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you are going to raise it in 3 days? But the temple he had spoken of was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said. Then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken. Now, while he was in Jerusalem at the Passover feast, many people saw the miraculous signs he was doing and believed in his name. But Jesus would not entrust himself to them, for he knew all men. He did not need man's testimony about man, for he knew what was in man." Obviously, this same zeal that he demonstrated antagonized his opposition. The Jews, and it probably refers to not only the Jewish leaders, but all the other Jews there at that time. And them being Jews, they should have naturally stood by Jesus, even joined him in restoring true worship in the temple. Instead, they objected against it. And you see, they couldn't object to what he did. They couldn't find any cause for that. It was a righteous cause, what he did. So they objected, questioned the authority he had to do it. And authority that he already demonstrated. As I said before, he did it without assistance or resistance. He accomplished it by his mere presence. Turn to Psalm 114. Short Psalm 114. Start with verse 1. When Israel came out of Egypt, the house of Jacob from people of foreign tongue, Judah became God's sanctuary, Israel his dominion. The sea looked and fled, the Red Sea. The Jordan turned back, the river stopped. The mountains skipped like rams, the hills like lambs. Why was it, O sea, that you fled? O Jordan, that you turned back, you mountains that you skip like rams, you hills like lambs. Tremble, O earth, at the presence of the Lord, at the presence of God of Jacob, who turned a rock into a pool, the hard rock into springs of water. Amen. Amen. Seas opened up, rivers stopped flowing. Mountains and hills danced around like animals, simply at the presence of God. They didn't recognize that authority because they didn't want to. Jesus knew that their hard-heartedness had already defiled one temple and it would destroy another one, his body. Yet, having purged the temple that they defiled, he knew that he would raise the one that they destroyed. Indeed, he did. And indeed, his disciples, being eyewitnesses to his resurrection, they believed. And indeed, empowered by the Holy Spirit, they came to understand the truth of his very words later on, but they come to understand the truth. And that reform that Jesus began on this occasion continues today. If we allow him, as the song the worship team says, he will purge from our hearts all darkness, and he will raise up within us a light in a life that can never be destroyed. What is your passion today? What is your desire? What moves you? I hope with all my heart that you can say it is Jesus Christ and none other. None other. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for Jesus and his zeal to obey you and to follow that obedience all the way to the cross. We thank you for the power of his Holy Spirit as he gives it to us to help cleanse us on the inside, to purge the things that we need purged. Lord, we cannot do it ourselves, but you look inside, you know exactly what it is. You know how to do it. You have the power to change us. I just thank you, Lord, that you love us so much that you want to do that in us. And I pray, Lord, that we allow you to change us, continue to transform us, purge what needs to go, provide what needs to stay. And Lord, we thank you and praise you. We ask this in your precious name. Amen. Worship team.
with us. Purify my heart.
Purify my heart. Let me be as gold and precious silver. Purify my heart. Let me be as gold.
Says he did not need man's testimony about man, for he knew what was in man. Jesus knows everything about each one of us, and he doesn't need anybody else's help. He knows when we're hurting. He knows when we're pretending. And he knows what's in us that needs to be purged. Trust what Jesus knows. Praise God.
I'm ready to do your